Exciting promises and crucial challenges. IVF as a major technology to provide infertility treatment has been a boon for many infertile couples, especially in metros. But now it has started breaking boundaries to benefit not just childless married couples, but also a single male wanting to become a father. But there are also challenges in how to convince people not to ask for prenatal sex selection and ensure no one is exploited through the process of surrogacy. Social awareness campaigns and clear policy and regulatory guidelines could be very helpful in this. But is the government as sensitive to the needs of the medical fraternity? To speak on this, we have Dr. Sudha Prasad, Head of Reproductive Medicine, Maulana Azad Medical College, Dr. Nalini Mahajan, President, Fertility Preservation Society of India and Director, Mother and Child Hospital, Dr. K.D.Nayar, Consultant Infertility and IVF, Akanksha IVF Center, Mata Chanan Devi Hospital, Dr. Neena Malhotra, Professor ART Center, AIMS, and the moderator for the event, for the panel, Dr. M. Gouri Devi, President-elect, Indian Fertility Society and Chair, Advocacy Committee, Indian Fertility Society. Over to you, Ms. Dr. Devi. Thank you.
Wasting time on introductions. Let me start with, when the first test tube baby was born in 1978, from then onwards, IVF or assisted reproductive technologies, they have really progressed. There is so much of innovations and so much of inventions that were done in assisted reproductive technologies, and we have seen a very fast progress in the last 30 years. Along with it came other ethical, legal and regularity issues. Now, in India, we are supposed to be having about 25 to 27 million infertile patients, and hardly 1% of them have access to infertility treatment. Now, my first question is to Dr. Neena Malhotra. Does the, in the National Health Mission, is any importance given to infertility? And is art only for upper and middle class people?
Yes, I think the figures that Dr. Gouri has just updated, that only 1% of the 25 million couples in the country get access. I would just like to say that we are an overpopulous country. And I think we should not forget that in this presence of high fertility, there is infertility which is coexisting in almost 8 to 10% of couples in the reproductive healthcare. So in the reproductive ages. So if we sort of extrapolated, the numbers are huge. Now we know that we are talking about family planning, and that's the agenda on the top of the mind of most of our policymakers or on the politician's mind. But I think it's important to realize that there is something called planning for the family. So if you look at the National Health Mission, it talks about mother and child. It talks about 58% of the population being covered on all kind of, you know, health policies that have come up on birthing, on anemia prophylaxis. There's somebody talking about the child survival, the Janani Suraksha Yojana, and the likes, and even including mental health. Now, we know that in India, where womanhood equates to, you know, a motherhood is something with which a woman proves herself to be a woman, it's definitely bound to have a very, very negative psychosocial impact. But unfortunately, there's nothing which the National Health Mission offers to infertility. There's not even a basic semen analysis, leave aside, you know, advanced technologies, available in district hospitals. So on the infertility aspect, there's hardly any, you know, sort of care available in the present day.
So that is the present day scenario as far as the basic district level or a village level infertility care is concerned. Now, coming to some of the, we are also to discuss about the, what are all the, you know, exciting promises. Dr. Nalini Mahajan is the president of Fertility Preservation Society of India. I have to ask her, how can ART help the reproductive issue in young patients who have undergone cancer treatment? And in the regulatory bill that they have put forth on the table, it has not yet become a law. They said no embryo can be frozen for more than 5 years. So what is your opinion on both?
The first thing is that the awareness that young women who have, or men who have undergone cancer treatment, can become subfertile or infertile, even that awareness isn't there. So one, the basic awareness isn't there. Two, oncologists do not counsel the patient that this may happen to you, and therefore please go and talk to a fertility specialist and see if you can somehow preserve your gametes so that after the cancer treatment is done, you can actually use those gametes for, you know, to have a full family life. We talk about quality of life these days for cancer survival, and cancer survivorship is very high, almost up to 80%, especially in the young, in pediatric patients. Now, the problem here is that the government has put some kind of an arbitrary cap, 5 years. From where they got this, we don't know. They have probably picked it up from HEFA, but they don't know that HEFA is, or this is the Embryology Act in the UK. But they probably don't see beyond. They don't read beyond. They just read that one sentence and have put that. Now, patients with cancer, 5 years is nothing. They are still undergoing treatment and post-treatment follow-up. They have to have their embryos preserved or their eggs or sperm preserved for a much longer period of time. So what should they do? If they preserve it, then do they throw it away after that kind of time? So our legislation and the bill that has been introduced, they're going to pass it as a law now, has so many lacunae in it which need to be discussed. They need to be discussed with specialists who understand the aspect. They cannot be done by bureaucrats because they don't know the nuances. So I think it's an absolute no-no. We have to discuss this, and this needs to be changed, because then this whole, you know, the population in India, 60%, about 65% is under 35, and 50% is under 25. Now, the pediatric age group, what is going to happen to them? Where the survival is the highest, 24% of them land with fertility problems. So they have actually nowhere to go. Socially, they are ostracized. Marriage becomes an issue. In our country, marriage, children is a huge issue. And so you are actually not allowing these people to have their reproductive rights. So that is a very important aspect.
Nalini? Now, surrogacy for Indians and for foreigners, there is a move to legally ban the commercial surrogacy. What is your take on it, Dr. Sudha?
See, in a healthcare system, how the IVF came, as the patient had the problem of conceiving spontaneously, automatically, so finally the in vitro fertilization, and we started taking care of the IVF part. And then, if the uterus is not there, then the surrogacy came, that your uterus is not fine, it may be not developed. If it is developed, probably due to some problem, some synechia, some adhesion, the cavity is not complete or a small cavity. In those cases, the sperms of the husband and the ovary, the eggs are there. But slowly, gradually, the system has become a industrial. So what has happened? That now the Indian, initially the Indian population was going through surrogacy, whoever were needed. Now in India, more than 25,000 babies are there, and more than 50% are from abroad. So question comes whether this surrogacy really requires for those people who are coming from outside and just getting our Indian women as a surrogate. This is a big question mark. As we know, today I had a CME on contraception, and we found in discussion that the contraception is not reaching to the each woman of the India. So what has happened? That each patient in little rural urban area, there are more than 3 children, 4 children. And now those people of the lower society have become surrogates. And finally, we are not thinking of the maternal mortality. After 3 children, the patient can have a postpartum hemorrhage. She will have the problem in saving. I am in a government hospital. I see every day, in every month, we discuss the maternal mortality. It is more than 3, 4, 5. And it looks very, very upsetting, frustrating. And those women are going for the surrogates, for the international commissioned people. So if the Indians, for the Indians, yes, I feel there should be a committee, they should really screen, and if it is the problem that the patient can have the surrogate. So once in a lifetime, in our guideline, whatever the ICMR was making more than 10 years, it has been made and still it is the guideline and it is lying in the cabinet probably. So in those cases, still we are not completed till guideline is not there. Patients are coming from abroad and they are taking the baby from here, and what is happening to those babies? Once all we have read also this news at Bombay airport, every 6 monthly one person is coming and taking a baby. From where the babies are going and how the babies are going? Even now the sperms are not there from the couple, the ova is not there, everything is donated, uterus of somebody, sperm of some other person, third person is giving the egg and the baby is formed. It has become a totally industry, and I think we need to stop this industry. This is my own feeling.
Coming again, that is basically because we do not have a regulatory bill and a regulatory authority. Once that falls in place, whether surrogacy for Indians or surrogacy for foreigners, we are exploiting the woman.
Very rightly said. Because
what do you say, Dr. K?
I think I agree with you. It's a commercial exploitation of the woman. And for me personally, I am against the surrogacy for foreigners. The foreigner people, American, they have to pay $100,000 for one surrogacy in USA. The same couple comes to India and pays 2 lakh rupees and engage a surrogate. That is one issue. Other issue is why it has become a talking point. They are gay couples, the HIV positive husbands, men coming from abroad, engaging our Indian women to carry on the pregnancy, which we ourselves here are not doing for HIV positive and for gay couple. And they are engaging this poor Indian woman to produce their child.
But one is not in Indian with an HIV, you have to have a separate lab.
Agent from abroad, they are the one who are promising the HIV positive men, gay couple, that they can come to India.
But the labs here shouldn't take them.
Actually, this system.
But the point remains that what KD is saying is very correct, that you are exploiting your women.
Exactly.
Yes.
That's so I agree.
We don't know what kind of testing has done, whether their report they're showing you is okay or not, and you transmit infection to that woman.
Exactly.
So I completely agree. This people from abroad should actually be banned from having, using Indian surrogates. But even within India, I think the law or the screening for who needs surrogacy should be very strict.
Yeah.
It's only the people who need should be allowed, and not now people, I'm having too much vomiting, I'll go for surrogacy.
Actually, there are more than 3,000 IVF centers, and without the proper guideline, this is the reason we do not know which person is doing surrogacy and how to correct them and how to catch them. But due to few of such kind of people, the whole IVF system, whole IVF healthcare system is pointed out that the surrogacy is done. And we every day we hear the news, 90 years old is getting, is delivering a baby, 78 years old in the Punjab or Haryana or somewhere. And this, what was the actor who was the just, Tushar, got the baby and everybody was happy. I think that we have absolutely changed our emotion. The child comes and the parents, the mother and the father of the child are becoming happy and giving the same kind of pleasure to the child. And child is growing in that whole environment. We have become totally commercialized. This is my feeling.
One point here I have to ask, we are not allowing foreigners to come and do surrogacy. And you made a point that we don't know what they're doing with the babies. Now, if that is the concern, why are we allowing foreigners to come and adopt
you? We should not. Rather, we should not. Why the babies will go? We do not know exactly.
But adoption law permits foreigners come and take.
That also.
But those laws are fairly strict. The adoption rules are fairly strict.
But we do not know. But who goes and
looks? No, but the adoption law is so strict that it will take them years before they actually get a baby.
But still they are going.
Here they can have, as you said, uh-huh. every 6 months somebody can have, there are 5 surrogates going at the same time.
Right, very rightly said.
We need a very clear cut law and a regulatory body who should be able to monitor the IVF sector. And like what Dr. Sudha said, there are 3,000 IVF clinics and most of them are doing unregulated, untransparent work which create a lot of myths about the IVF in the general population. We have to erase these myths which are being created. Unless we have a regulatory body which can monitor all the work, all the centers, we are going to live with myths.
But the problem with the regulatory bodies is that it's always the bureaucrats and some odd person who has no knowledge of IVF who becomes into the regulatory body. And we are going to have a similar thing that we have for PCP and DT, where you are filling thousands of forms. You'll get into jail if you don't fill up something. Of course, Supreme Court can make a clerical error, but the doctor will go to jail for making a clerical error. And how has the sex ratio changed? Nothing has changed. If you go on the net and look at the Delhi figures, nothing has changed.
Like you see,
pure harassment. So unless and until you have a regulated body with some sense, you have experts in the field who know what is right, what is wrong, and what should be done, there's no point in having a regulatory body with some bureaucrat sitting and some person who doesn't know what is the eye of IVF.
Yes.
We have to have some sort of body like they have in UK or USA.
Yeah.
Like our health minister was mentioning about the female child ratio, and he was also under the impression of the so-called myth that IVF centers are able to do a sex selection. We are all IVF specialists. Can any one of us still there? Can we do a sex selection?
No. Unless we go for
that investigation is behind. In PGD or PGS, we do only when there is a genetic disorder or sex link disorder. In those cases, like a female child is having this kind of problem, so we have to find out. Not in a normal IVF, nobody can find out that if we are putting the embryos, whether it will be a male or a female. So it is very, very difficult. I think this is a myth that the IVF centers are producing only the boys.
Yeah.
Yes.
No, but just when you said about this, you are not even allowed, even in sex link disorders, they will not reveal the sex of the embryo. So you will, all that will be told to you is you can transfer,
normal,
which could be
embryos.
A carrier.
Yes.
No. It can be a carrier. That will be written. And we had one patient who created a shindy because she said, I've spent so much money and you will again put a, and it may be a carrier. I don't know what you're putting in me. And I spent so much money. I didn't want my child to have the same problem that I'm having. And now, you know, what is it? What's the point of not telling me the sex? And because it is a sex link disorder.
Yeah.
So
what do you have to say?
But I think these are norms which we know when we do even prenatal diagnosis. If there is a fetus and if either parents is a carrier, say for even for hemophilia, we don't outright tell the sex. If you're doing a codinula sampling, we tell whether it's a diseased fetus which is affected as or it's a carrier state. I think the rules by and large are same, and as I think ethically, morally, we are responsible citizens of the country. So I think as IVF specialists, as the word goes, it is absolutely to be sort of, you know, clarified. And I think we should always have media on our side to help us. Because the way surrogacy is going, I think partly with, you know, some celebrities, I don't want to name, I'm sure you know Shah Rukh Khan went in for, Amir Khan went in for, was it really a genuine case of surrogacy? And I think that gives a lot of impetus to the common man and the public. Yes, surrogacy can be for their sort of benefits because the woman doesn't want to go through 9 months of pregnancy. So I think the legislation, and Dr. Nalini pointed out, we should have law which should be friendly, not just for the patients, our clients, but also for the doctors, because here we are a community who are actually there to help rather than being harassed for whatever the way law puts things.
Now, as we are on to this regulation, I can't tell you the whole of the bill that has been put on the this thing in the cabinet. This has been going on. This tabling of the bill has been going on from 2006.
Yeah.
For the last 10 years, it's come to the parliament. Some innovations has occurred. It has again gone back. It has again come back. Now, the latest bill, if I read out the whole thing to you, it is, unless proved otherwise, the doctor is at fault. That is what the whole bill is about. I can't read the whole thing, but one particular thing about offenses and penalties. What they say is either the embryologist, the gynecologist, or any medical practitioner who is in the ART Bangor clinic, what they are saying is that either on an honorary basis or otherwise, who contravenes any of the provisions of this act or rules thereunder shall be punished with the imprisonment for a term which may extend up to 5 years or with a fine of 10 lakhs or both. And if there is a repeat subsequent contravention, then it's imprisonment up to 7 years. What do you say, Dr. Sudha?
See, as the regulations are not there, and you said since 2005 or 6, it is going on. And I am also a member of this ART
so
bill.
Why did you not object?
So, lot of objection. But you know, finally, whenever the bill went there, it was something like this only, that this is there. Probably, what I feel, that due to every day, so much of mushrooming of the IVF centers are there. So, somebody is not a gynecologist having an IVF center, employing somebody, and who is not a proper embryologist in doing. So there is no control at all. This is the reason probably this kind of punishment has been kept. When the guideline will be there and it will pass through, I don't think it will be included in
that. How do we know that? There should be a regulation for what defines an IVF clinic. Who can start an IVF clinic? What is the staffing pattern that you should have? What is the specialist pattern that you should have? But you cannot make a doctor liable for everything. They even make you liable for the death of the patient. She die in a road accident, but you are, because she was coming to the clinic or going from the clinic, you become liable and you are in jail. So this is kind of
totally
ridiculous.
So we have to stick
ridiculous.
To the guideline. I think we should do the ethical practice. Then probably we won't land up to this level.
No, but this is going to pass. It's just that every time this bill goes into the parliament, there's some hangama, somebody's throwing chairs, something else is happening. So this bill goes back. That's why probably we've been saved, actually.
Yes.
Maybe this might have just gotten passed.
Actually, from IFS, we have represented to them and we have given them a legal... Make the punishment according to the quantum of the crime committed. You can't make a doctor criminal for everything. That is the gist of it. Dr. Nayar, what do you say? No known ovum donor or sperm donor to be used.
Yes, sir, that is in the ART bill pending. And generally speaking, if you have a donor which is known to the husband and wife or to the family, they think that that is a safe bet. But if you look in a long-term issue, you should have an anonymous donor, which is the practice abroad. If you need a donor, give it.
No. In America, UK, known donors, in fact, altruistic donation is allowed. That's a different story, that very few people come forward altruistically to donate to them. Therefore, they've gone the way, you know, UK has most of its donors coming from Spain because that's ready money for young girls and college-going university students. But if you look at it, when there is an organ donation happening, or for that matter, we can't equate it. But a world over, if, you know,
organ donation is a different issue.
I agree, but if you look
but
at
I'll
FDA,
tell you the,
HFE allows the...
I will no. tell you the emotional part of this. One family I know very, very closely, he had 3 sons. And 1 son was given to the brother. These 2 sons were not doing very well in the life. They didn't have the proper business. And the donated one, the adopted one, is doing very, very well. And every time the parent is looking at, wo mera beta hai, lekin maine usko de diya. Every time it is giving this kind of pressure. And I'm telling you,
that was
same thing will happen if the known donor will be there.
That is your choice.
The welfare of the child, you know, if there is a WSE, which we call internationally, that if the parents sign the welfare, and I think it's time that our society would recognize, because coming from a public funded hospital, if I say my IVF cycle costs 60,000 and the agency which gives or provides a donor charges 1 lakh rupees, is it making an IVF affordable to people where we are talking of cutting costs and adding to the cost for an agency? I think that's the downside of it. Maybe very few people would be able to afford a donor. But yes, if it's altruistic, I think things should be very well clarified. And like the HFEA permits and welfare of the child form, we have something like that coming up. Again, who's going to inform?
the ICMR or the lawmakers, somebody amongst us, rather than give it to the bureau, I mean, somebody in the policymakers who doesn't understand, I think the financial aspect of the donation has to be also taken
no,
care.
Apart from that, Neena, the genetic aspect, no, this is something which I think it is very important for all of us. You, for the first time comes and you suggest donor, it's a huge shock. Then they finally adjust to that and they say, can we know the donor? How do we know the history? How do we know the background? How do we know the genetic? They are very genuine questions. We laugh them away, but they are very genuine questions. If you had to do it, you will think 20 times. So if they have a sister or a bhabhi willing to donate, they know the background. They are taking the same risk.
But I'm telling you, Dr. Nalini, in a long run, this is going to create a problem.
No,
very well.
It is the same thing as adoption. It's the same thing as adoption.
Yes.
It's their choice.
Because I have seen by my own eyes, every day they used to see that son, that but it is given. They cannot have the hold on that boy. And he's doing so well, these people are not doing well. So every now and then they used to cry. Same thing will happen if some bhabhi is
given. That is their choice. No, that is your
choice. So this will be, this will happen in the long run. So anonymous person is always the best. The only thing, our screening system should be very good.
How can you
screen?
Shall
I ask one of the audience?
If you ask even an educated person, an educated couple comes to you and you take the family history, this everything's fine. No one has anything. Then you go a little, dig a little deeper, ask some leading question. They will have diabetes also, they will have hypertension also, they will have cancers also in the family. They don't know. Half the time you don't know. Then you tell them, you know, go ask your mother. Go ask so and so exactly what this was. They don't know. So how do you expect these people to know? What screening are you going to do? You cannot do screening for the whole family.
Anyone
extended
from
family.
The audience, any opinion?
Yeah.
No, donor is a female donor is a real problem. See, sperms which are used from donors are actually cryopreserved. So here we are using a donor who is a live human being who is being stimulated, and we retrieve her egg. So it's nothing that, like a sperm, you cannot have the eggs frozen and then use. So the story is very different. So you'll have a woman there for a particular patient who needs egg donation, and that will be
You can have it frozen also, except that it's more complicated, and there's a whole lot of medication which goes into the woman. For the sperm donation, nothing of that sort happens. You know, you can just donate, and that's the end of the story. But let me tell you the story of sperm banks in Delhi. We once asked the sperm bank that, you know, the person wants the particular religion. So he says, what religion? We don't ask religion. Why are you asking these strange questions? We cannot ask 100,000 things. But they are supposed to. They should have everything.
See, when you are talking of religion, when we go to the blood bank, we say only I need a E positive blood. We do not say it should be of certain religion.
It's not genes.
So I think
religion.
We should stop talking about the religion.
I just give you an example. If I asked education, I'm sure they don't even know the education. So I'm just giving you an example that the records or the details they maintain, somebody was talking about the data and details, the details they maintain are pathetic. There are no details.
That is sure. That is all right.
I mean, this religion came up because it just happened. But
I'll put one more question. Dr. Nalini touched on it. Single parent, I am not talking about foreigners. These are Indians. Single parent, man or a woman, opting for a child. I am an unmarried woman. And I want to marry, and I want to have a child.
I think we should have some sort of a regulatory agency who should be able to evaluate the screening of such single parents, men or women. And like for, say, adoption, you have to go through this. The idea is that a single parent can have a child, but the welfare of the child has to be assured. There has to be some system which can assure the looking up of this, bringing up of the child. So there has to be some sort of a committee or any department which can give this permission. It's not every Tom, Dick and Harry coming, walking, the single parent, I want to have a baby.
Everything under ethical and lawful. But there has the whole IRT bill is silent on this. There is no comment whatsoever. What about the same sex? Related to partners opting for a child, Indians, not foreigners.
Neena.
Okay. I think again it's again morality and ethics or whatever. As of now, I don't think we are in a state to say yes, we would accept gay couples, because are we willing to take that? That's a big question. And I think I would ask the public, what do you feel? Should we
I
really
think
have
this question should be thrown to the
audience. How do you feel? Because when I asked my resident about, because in the law, a single mother can be allowed or is allowed to undergo an IVF cycle. So the men residents of my unit said, why not men? Why it's
discrimination.
A gender discrimination? Yeah. So I realized that there were kind of, inputs coming from, because when this Tushar Kapoor story came, I thought, let me take the feedback from my people, because we have a mix of both boys and girls, I'm the male and female residents. So I just wanted to throw this question to the public. How do you feel? How would society like to have gay couples coming up with their own children?
I'm Dr. Rajiv. I'm a surgeon. I have a take on this. I think the society which we are, I think it's a part of the sickness syndrome, I would say. We are glorifying Tushars and Sushmita Sains and all those who are trying. What is the issue? The issue is the child's welfare. Are we considering that? Is a child safe with Mr. Tushar Kapoor? I have genuine doubts if anybody is safe with him anyway. And how are we going to say that that two gays or two lesbians can have a child when the right of the child is to have, at least he technically should have a pair, father and a mother, say a male and a female, for proper, psychological well-being, adapting to the society and everything. Unfortunately, somebody may go, there may be incidents in the family that is a part of life, which is not in one individual's control. But how can we say that two gays, two lesbians, one Mr. Tushar, one Ms. Sushmita can have children, and there's no, what are the rights of the child? He's not experiencing the love of a father, the love of the mother, the scolding of the father or the anger of the mother. Where is that experience? Have you not deprived this child of some very basic necessities? Nobody is thinking of that. Secondly, why is the IVF industry never talking of adoptions? And I have referred so many couples to IVF centers, including, well, let's not name them. Not a single one has been counseled. Ki, look, there is this problem, and you have to go for adoption. And why not go for adoption in the first place?
One thing.
We are full of so many.
Everybody has a right to reproduction. You cannot tell a person that I can do IVF for you, but sorry, go for adoption. I'm sorry, it is against their reproductive rights. You can say if they've failed or if they have a problem wherein you feel that no, this is not going to work for them, then you offer them adoption, and we definitely, all of us offer adoption, but you cannot tell a person who has come to you with hope. Do you tell a person who has come to you with hope to take this organ out and transplant this? I'm sorry, this is... Why don't you just go and, now live on dialysis? Dialysis is available.
You yourself can try before referring, ask them to adopt.
You have
see, because
to,
there is this
offer.
Stigma attached to adoption, which is that this child is, this is a, this
people
whole thing of mine, mine, mine.
Yes,
this whole thing, when actually neither is the egg of the individual,
yes,
nor the sperm is of
that
the individual,
is
nor is the child of the individual. But still, it is being offered as my thing, which is the whole crux of the whole thing. It is not that the lady may even have an embryo. I mean, what is the embryo? May is one egg. X,
oocyte.
One egg, oocyte is there. Sperm may be from some X, Y, Z person who she never met. What is the big deal if she adopts? What's the big deal about it? It's how we counsel and educate.
That's what she asked to the patient.
I'll stay with you. We always say adoption, but
they don't
how it bounces back. They said, doctor, we want to give one shot, one try, because she has to prove her womanhood by being a mother, and that's what the society is all about. We know that it's very difficult to change the mindset, but that's how we have evolved. But trust us, as doctors, we really know that there are situations where we are helpless. We can't. They still want to give against the odds. Let
against
us try against
odds.
The odds. We do explain that the odds are against you, but still, it's coupled. So I think more for this, because at times they come back and say, at least we are not guilty when we are 50 that we did not try. Let us give us that opportunity, that pleasure. So I think when that comes to an answer coming, I said, fine, if that gives them a peace, because psychologically they are not at guilt that they did not try, is perhaps one of the reasons we said, okay, fine. But then consenting is very
But not
clear.
At the age of 85, no. That I will die with this, that I have not
no, no,
that,
no,
is that, that is
not
that is totally
not
different
talk,
yes.
Not
that
not.
Story.
But we're just talking to somebody who has a poor ovarian reserve, and we just suggest, and they don't want to try take over, egg donors, they want to still try. So we do explain that, yes, your odds are low, because they want to say, I should not go with this guilt that I did not give myself a shot. Let
it's
me
called
that.
Reproductive regret.
Which is very common.
And
I think it should
say,
be more
easy.
About...
If you have, God forbid, somebody in your family in that situation, ask them. And then
I counsel them for adoption.
No,
I have counseled
counsel
many of my relatives for adoption.
Counsel. You may counsel.
But it's for
will
the couple
accept
to
it?
Accept.
Yeah, many, two of them have also accepted adoption.
That's fine. Informed consent. I think as responsible doctors, we do inform them of all the available options. But it's informed consent. So.
And secondly, well, Dr. Nair made a point that surrogacy is somehow tainted. See, once you have started playing with chromosomes, with eggs and sperms, this is bound to happen. This is technology. You have sort of let the Pandora out of the box. Now you can't stop the technological advancements. To say that I will use this for this purpose is not in your hands. It'll go out. And to say that somebody is getting a surrogacy in US for so many dollars and it's getting, this is same with, this is medical tourism. He's getting a CABG there for so many dollars and he gets it here in rupees. So I don't think that is a big issue. And surrogacy, why should it be so bad? When you are transferring, when we transferred virus chromosomes into bacteria and created clones of E. coli which were resistant to all antibiotics, was not that the first step of disaster? Now that we have MSRAs, was not that the first step of disaster because we played around with chromosomes that time. And now we have MSRA resistant, E. coli, MSRA is stall or resistant. Why? Because now similarly, this technological advancement we have unleashed. Now what is there? If I take... No, regulate about why? If some, why do you want to regulate what? What do you want to regulate? You have got an X, you have got a Y, you have got somebody who... There will be a time when the embryo will be growing in the peritoneum.
Can I just...
Then...
No, it may happen.
And then men will be growing these things in their peritoneums.
Can I just put a little rationalize that? We can get emotional about all these things and we all have our emotions, you know, on one side or the other. But the rationality is that you... What we are looking at is exploit. Within that purview, if you do not exploit a woman, she has the right to decide whether she wants to be a surrogate and for what. So that is, we have to look that she is not getting exploited. That's what the whole debate was. It has gone into various areas because of certain unscrupulous people and what they have done. And that's why it went into those territories. But the basic ground fact and reality is that you are trying to prevent exploitation of these women, either by their husbands or by agents, so that you know, they are just forced into something because the husband wants drinking money. I had a patient who, the husband was forcing her to donate eggs because, and you could see he was an alcoholic, so I refused. I said, I'm sorry, I'm not going to do it. And he created such a shindy in my reception. I want, this is Diwali, I have to buy gifts for my children. He was totally dead drunk. And he wanted his wife to, she had donated once, he wanted her to donate all over again. So that is the kind of exploitation that one, the government and whatever, any sensible human being would want, that there should be no exploitation. If she is willingly doing something with her full knowledge, with what she says, I'm fine with doing this, she's healthy, she has been screened for everything, then and only then. So we have to have certain regulations. We have unscrupulous people putting in 5 embryos into a woman. How do you stop that? You have to have a regulation to do
but
it.
But this control is not there because there is so many IVF center mushrooming of every month, every week, I must tell. So this is not. The sensible IVF specialist definitely will do this good counseling, but not everybody. This is the reason the bad name or fame, whatever you say, is coming for this.
I think we have a time. And any questions, anyone has?
What about anecdotal
See, posthumous is not allowed.
The guidelines that has come, not tabled yet, only one sentence is there, that if the husband is in coma and the wife wants to take this for her child, that is allowed. Apart from that, there's no
consent. It is prior consent.
Yeah, prior.
Like we've done one patient, the husband had frozen his sperms. He had cancer. He knew that he would not survive. He froze his sperm. The woman then came back for IVF after a couple of years and got it done and had a baby. But there has to be prior consent. You cannot take it otherwise. In fact, you cannot use the partner cannot use the embryo unless she has prior consent of the
husband. Last case reported in newspapers was regarding a patient who had an accident and died because of that.
Not allowed. At least by the bill, it's not allowed.
And even the oldest authority, the HFP in the UK, does not permit posthumous, use of gametes unless and until
it is all
consent. And obviously, accidental cases, nobody would consent prior. So it's an absolute no-no.
So anybody consents before, say if I put in my will that...
Absolutely.
Then
you
that
can You can use it.
You can use it.
I think we'll stop it there. So there are many controversies, but I think
we don't have the time.
Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. This brings us to the end of today's program. On behalf of the entire family of the Economic Times and ET Health World, we would like to thank you for managing time from your busy schedules and taking us to the depths of Indian healthcare scenario. We would be delighted if you could share your experiences on Twitter with hashtag India Health Forum. We would also like to thank GE, the founding partners of ET Health World. Please keep coming back to Economic Times Health World and educate and enlighten our readers. Thank you very much. Please join us for dinner. Have a very good night. Thank you.